watching from home, welcome. And I think Bonnie's watching us. Good morning, Bonnie. Hope you're doing well.
Mm-hmm.
Still praying for your full recovery. Anybody else need prayer this morning? We're continuing to pray for the school community because we've had a lot of people in quarantine. We've had at school this week, we had 21 staff members out, most of them being quarantined, but a few of them were not out on quarantine. They were out for other reasons. But that's a lot of staff members missing. That's like a third of our staff, so it has put us in kind of a dysfunctional a mode of, you know, everybody else having to take up the slack. And so our people are great, and they always step up to do that. But it's hard. And we had six classes in quarantine this past week.
Wow.
So, you know, if somebody tests positive, anybody who's been in close proximity to them has to go. They have to go home, and that's just the way it works. So it's a crazy thing. And schools, you know, it's a little consolation to us knowing that we're not the only ones. Schools all over the country are struggling in the same way, and not just our country, but around the world. Schools around the world are struggling like this. It's, so. We need to continue to pray for an end to this pandemic because it continues to be a serious problem.
I think the other side of that, maybe a lot of people don't realize, especially outside the education community, is that how much it's dramatically affecting the quality of education. The students,
absolutely.
The students and what they are not learning.
Oh, absolutely.
Stuff, the virtual stuff, just is not as effective.
No, it isn't. And that's with us doing the very best
that we know
that can be done, that we know how to do. And our teachers are doing a phenomenal job in a very, very difficult scenario. They have students in the classroom, ours too, and they have students at home online, and so they're having to toggle back and forth to, you know, giving attention to the students online and having to give attention to the students there that are face-to-face in the classroom. Very difficult, very settles on this, and we're able to get everybody back in school. There's going to be a lot of catching up to do, and so there's that. And that's just one of the ripple effects of COVID. There are many others as well, but we're praying for those who are quarantined, who have tested positive and they're recovering, and you know, we still need to pray for Mike and Crystal, and I know I'm talking about them behind their back, but and Mr. Cole probably can attest to this, but I know Crystal is still not fully over it. She's tired in the afternoons. She admits, you know, that by 2:30 in the afternoon, she's totally wiped out. And it takes a while. Mm. It takes a while to get over it. Some of you guys who've had it, you probably can testify to the same thing, right?
I can't even tell you if it's true. I mean, I'm not back to normal.
You're not back to normal either?
No, I mean, this is about 2 months. You
know? About 2 months, yeah.
Yeah.
That's the reality of it.
My problem is if I get back to normal, it's a miracle.
Praying for a miracle.
Well, let's stop and pray, shall we? Before we get into our lesson this morning, let's just open it up for prayer. You guys have no people that we should be praying for, so just you pray and we'll agree. We'll all agree together. Amen.
Mm-hmm.
I tell you, John and Susan are already in the sanctuary.
I know. I'm so happy.
Praise the Lord.
So happy. Let's pray.
Father, we just thank you that John and Susan are here today, that he was able to get that all organized and worked out. We thank you for that. We just lift up those members of our congregation who can't be here, like Joy and Linton, and ask your blessing on them, and those who are still still under the effects of the COVID, like Crystal and many people here, Father. I also pray for my granddaughter who was just diagnosed with COVID, Peyton, that your health and healing would be on her for a quick recovery. Yes. And I thank you, Lord, for all you do. Thank you.
Heavenly Father, thank you for this day. What a beautiful day you've made. We thank you for the blessings. We thank you for healing. Thank you for the medicine change. I'm becoming regular again. I feel much better this week. That I went to the doctor. We pray and lift up Kathy, dear God. She's not feeling well. Got some headaches. And for all those that are missing and are sick or have been stricken that are home right now, but we want to lift up especially all the schools in our nation and their children, dear God, that we get back on track soon, that they are not discouraged, that they don't become confused and scared about every little illness out there that might come our way, which will, and they realize that this is just a temporary thing. You're in control, and we give you praise and glory, Jesus. In your name we pray, amen.
There's a weariness over people and a weariness, Father, over our school staff and everybody there. And Father, I just ask you for strength. Mm-hmm. Strength that comes from you, Father God. That you would help us, as your word says, to set our minds on Christ, mm-hmm. our Lord, Savior, and Redeemer.
Right.
That you would help us to walk this out, Father, with your strength and your encouragement, Lord. We ask it in Jesus' name.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord.
Lord, I ask that you give us understanding. I ask that you would
continue to lift up the United States of America.
Mm-hmm.
We ask you to bless our nation. Help us, Lord. Have mercy upon us. Lord, send repentance by your Spirit across the land.
Mm-hmm.
Lord, with this new administration, we just ask for your divine intervention and that you would, Lord, reveal yourself to each and every one. And Lord, bring about, Lord, your perfect will, that every decision that is made and all the laws that are passed, that everything, executive orders that are made, that everything that's happening, Lord, we just ask you to intervene and cause it, Lord, to align with your word and with your standards of righteousness.
Mm-hmm.
We ask, Lord, we continue to ask for an end to abortion in this country.
Yes,
mm-hmm.
That you would bring an end to the bloodshed, Lord,
mm-hmm.
the shedding of innocent blood.
Right.
Bring repentance, Lord. We repent.
Mm-hmm.
We ask you to bring repentance and heal our land. And now, Lord, as we look in your word, we just ask you to speak to us,
mm-hmm.
to open your word to us, to give us understanding by your Spirit. Teach us, we pray.
Mm-hmm.
In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
So we're in John 17 this morning. The last couple of weeks, you know, week before last, the emphasis was on the calling to discipleship, basically, calling, being called to follow. And we looked at Jesus calling the disciples who, at that time, that group that we looked at 2 weeks ago, were the fishermen. And he got their attention by giving them a miraculous catch. It flabbergasted them.
Yeah.
And Peter, to the point where Peter fell to his knees and acknowledged Jesus' lordship. And Jesus gave them the invitation, follow me, and they did. And the same invitation that he extends to us. And those of us in this room, I guess each and every one of us in here, we heard that invitation, and we accepted it as well. Jesus said, follow me, and we were like, I'm in. Yes, Lord, I'm in. And then last week, we talked about his authority, where Jesus, in a situation where he was teaching in a house, and it was packed out, and some friends were bringing a paralytic, a man who was paralyzed, and they couldn't get into the room, and so they fought outside of the box a little bit. They went up on the roof, and they tore a hole in the roof, and they let the man down so that Jesus could minister to him. And Jesus told him his sins were forgiven, and there were religious leaders in the audience, and they were offended by that. In their mind, that was blasphemy. And so Jesus knew their thoughts, and he said, he gave them a teaching. He gave them instruction. He gave them some facts. You know, he said, look, what's easier, to say your sins are forgiven or to say, take your bed up and walk? Get up, take your bed and walk. So he said, so that you will know that the Son of Man has authority to forgive sins on the earth. And then he didn't even finish that statement. He just redirected his attention. Hey, John, it's so good to see you, man.
Hey.
You're a sight for sore eyes.
Likewise, you guys too.
Thank you.
Too long.
It's just an expression. It's just an expression. It's like, I'm sorry. It just means we're so glad to see you.
Right. But my eyes are sore, though.
So Jesus directed his attention then to the paralytic, to the young man who was paralyzed, and he addressed him by as son, or young man. He said, rise, take up your bed, and go home. And got up and walked. And so it's a wonderful thing. And so Jesus established the fact that he has authority to forgive sins. And basically, he is the Messiah. He was demonstrating that he is the Messiah, has divine authority. He has God's authority because they didn't realize it. They didn't realize it at the time. But they were looking at God incarnate. The Messiah is God in the flesh. And so Jesus has authority. Jesus has authority. And so before we get into today's lesson, I just wanted to drill down on that just a little bit more and kind of recap last week's emphasis that he has authority on, he had authority on the earth, and he has authority now. And, you know, he said all authority in heaven and in earth had been given to him. And that was the reason he was able to commission us and delegate to us that authority. Remember when he said, I give you authority? Can you finish that statement? I give you authority to trample on snakes and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy. In fact, somebody read that for us, Luke 10:19. Let's read it from the scriptures, Luke 10:19.
Behold, I give you the authority to trample on serpents and scorpions and over all the powers of the enemy, and nothing shall by anything hurt you.
So he has authority, and he with that authority, he can delegate that authority to us. He's given authority to us. I don't know if you think about that, that Jesus has given you authority over all the power of the enemy. Probably need to be reminded of that every day, don't we?
Yeah.
I'm not sure we know how to wield that authority very well, but we have it. We're still maybe a little out of practice, you know, in how to implement that authority that we've been given. It's one thing to have authority delegated to you. It's another thing to know how to use it well. Anyway, that's a whole other discussion for another day.
That's why the Holy Spirit is with us. Yeah. Teach us and train us and show us.
That's right. Amen. So today we're over in John 17, and the lesson is called for world's belief, called for the world's belief. And verses 14 through 24, I've asked Josiah if he would read those for us. Josiah, can you read nice and loud so everybody in the room can hear you? John 17, 14 through 24.
Oh, yeah, sure. Please.
Thank you.
Sending them into the world, and I give myself as a holy sacrifice for them, so they can be made holy by your truth. I am praying not only for these disciples, but also for all who will ever believe in me through their message. I pray that they will all be one, just as you and I are one, as you are in me, Father, and I am in you. And may they be in us, so that the world will I have given them the glory you gave me, so they may be one as we are one. I am in them and you are in me. May they experience such perfect unity that the world will know that you sent me and that you love them as much as you love me. Father, I want these to be healing me to be with you what I am. Then they can see all the glory you gave me because you love me even before the world began.
Good job, Josiah. So this is a snippet. This is a part of Jesus' prayer. Our text today just kind of breaks into the middle of this prayer. Do you remember the setting for this prayer? What was going on? Where was Jesus? What was the setting? Yes, it was right after the Last Supper, what we traditionally call the Last Supper, the final Passover meal that Jesus shared with his band of brothers. And they're in the upper room, remember?
Mm-hmm.
Judas has already left the room. And so Jesus is still talking with them. And he has quite a lot to say to them. And so this is really just hours before he is arrested.
Mm-hmm.
He's arrested later on that night. But right now he's with his guys. And this is an intimate moment where he's just sharing with them his thoughts, and then he closes out his comments to them in the previous chapter 16, verse 33. He says, "I told you these things so that in me you may have peace. In this world you will have trouble, but take heart, I have overcome the world." Boy, that's a mouthful right there. And we could spend all the rest of the day just talking about that. In this world you will have trouble, but take heart, I have overcome the world. And then it says, after Jesus said this, chapter 17, verse 1, he looked toward heaven and prayed. So it's an interesting little insight to his mode of prayer. Traditionally, we bow our heads and close our eyes, and there's nothing wrong with that. But that's not the only way you can pray and pray appropriately. It's Jesus. We're told that Jesus lifted up, and he looked up, so his eyes were open, and he began to pray. And I've been in Jewish ceremonies where a lot of our Jewish friends continue to pray that way. They will pray looking up with their eyes open. So he starts to pray. Jesus begins to pray. He's with his disciples. He begins to pray. Now, before we talk about this, remember, he's already given them some lessons on how to pray, because the disciples, you know, earlier had said, "Lord, teach us to pray." And so he gave them the model prayer, and we've talked about that a lot, and I love the model prayer. I pray it often. And it's a solid template. That what we call the Lord's Prayer, the model prayer that Jesus gave us, man, it is a fantastic prayer template where we can take that as our beginning place with praying. But Jesus here then actually begins to pray, and what a wonderful privilege it is for us to have recorded for us his prayer.
Right.
And so, question 4 in your book, what was the first thing Jesus prayed for at the end of the Last Supper he shared with his disciples? What's the first thing he prayed for? I think before he said that, he prayed first for himself. He knew that his mission for being here, for coming to earth, was in order to become the Lamb of God, the perfect sacrifice, so that prayer is determination to complete that mission.
It kind of points out in his prayer, he recognizes that the apostles were given to him by God as a gift. And so he recognizes that in the process. And he goes, because you give me, all that I have is yours. The
right.
Apostles are yours. And glory has come to me through them, and he's kind of living in the world. So to some degree, he's recognizing to the Father and praying, these men are gifts.
Yeah.
Given to me by God, and ultimately for that purpose.
Right. Of course, to really get the answer to this, you have to go back in front of the verses that we started with in today's lesson. So, back to the beginning of the chapter, he said, Father, the time has come, glorify your Son, that your Son may glorify you. And so he prays for himself. And then the second thing he prayed for was the disciples, right?
Mm-hmm.
Amen?
Mm-hmm.
And he said, my prayer is not that you take them out of the world, but that you, the NIV says, protect them from the evil one. King James says, keep them from the evil. I like the NIV better in this particular passage. Protect them from the evil one. They are not of the world, even as I am not of it. Sanctify them by the truth. Your word is truth. So that word sanctify is used in most translations that I looked at. So he prayed here in this part of the prayer. He emphasizes two things. Protect them from the evil one. He's praying for his disciples. Sanctify them by the truth. As you sent me into the world, I have sent them into the world. For them, I sanctify myself, that they too may be truly sanctified. So there's a big emphasis here on them being sanctified. And Jesus, in his prayer, he's emphasizing the mission, his mission for coming. Jesus was extremely mission-minded. It was always right there in front of him, his mission. And so, and that's the dominant theme of John's gospel. The mission of Jesus is like one of the major themes of John's gospel. And it's given as a pattern for us, his followers. We too are to be mission-minded, as Jesus was. But protecting them from the evil one, one of the things that he prayed for in his model prayer that he gave them was, deliver us from the evil one. Remember that?
Mm-hmm.
How often do you guys pray that?
Yeah.
I pray it a lot. Deliver me from the evil one. And Jesus is praying for his guys. He's like, protect them from the evil one. And then he says, sanctify them. So what about this word sanctify? Anybody have any insights on it? What does that mean? I'm sorry?
Does it mean like to set aside?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Like separate yourself?
It does. Any other insights on it?
Is sanctification our journey? Our journey towards sanctification?
I think we are on a journey towards sanctification. But what is the sanctification? What is the end result? What's the end game?
The cleansing of evilness, the cleansing of evil thoughts, the cleansing of the world, of worldly control.
Yeah.
Just heavenly, purely heavenly driven, I would say.
Okay.
Body, mind, and soul.
Okay.
Amen.
Bill?
I would add to that, before I jump right on, to be God.
What?
To be his person. God has wanted, you go back and read in the Old Testament when he's getting started with Israel, he called them to be a people for his own possession, his people.
Mm-hmm.
That's what God is calling out a people for himself. And he wants people that are not half in love with him and half in love with the world, you know, but are really devoted to him. It says that so many times in the Bible, the reward, the good things are for those who love him.
That's good. Ken?
Sanctification was a part of what the Levites and the priests did before they went into the temple. It was a purification process, and so sanctification or consecration is something that is purified and set apart for a divine purpose. And so God is calling us to be purified and consecrated for his defined purpose, which is ultimately, you know, what Bill is doing. God cannot be in darkness. Darkness cannot be in his presence. He can't tolerate that. That's part of the reason that Jesus covers us. His blood covers our sin. His blood helps to sanctify us and prepare us and cleanse us for God's purpose and is calling into us.
Amen.
And when Jesus was praying that that we be not of the world, as he's not of the world, and the process to getting there is the sanctification, just like Ken was saying. The process we have to go through in order to be not of this world.
It definitely is a process, amen. It's an ongoing process. Yes, it is, as Kim was saying, giving the context of the way that term is used in the Old Testament, you know, taking not only people, but sometimes physical objects, you know, the vessels and the instruments that were used in the temple, they were sanctified, they were consecrated to God, and separated and set apart for holy purposes. And so the same is true of the disciples. Jesus was saying, I'm not praying, Lord, I'm not praying that you take them out of the world, but that you sanctify them, that you set them apart from the world for your holy purposes. And the same is true for us. We are in the world, but we're not of the world. He sanctifies us. He separates us. Come out from among them and be ye separate. He separates us and dedicates us to his purposes. And so there's a distinction. And when a person is called by God and set apart, sanctified, there is a noticeable difference. There should be a noticeable difference. And then that vessel, and we are vessels, we as vessels were set apart for God's holy purposes. And so we never totally get there while we're in the flesh, but we're making progress. We're being transformed. But you know, with Jesus praying this, and as he's praying it for his disciples, he know, I believe his prayer for the disciples bleeds over to us. We are his disciples too. We too are his disciples. And so he's praying for us to be protected from the evil one. He's praying for us to be sanctified. And so, do you think Jesus' prayer has any power?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Is there anything to it?
Yeah.
Do you think his prayer will get an answer?
Yeah.
Amen.
Absolutely.
Does that encourage you?
Yes. Yeah.
It encourages me.
He's ever interceding for us.
He's ever interceding for us.
It's very important we get that.
When the Messiah prays for you, watch out.
Mm-hmm.
So, what was the third thing Jesus prayed for? Question 6.
Those who would come to believe in him.
That's right. Did y'all hear Linda? Did y'all hear Linda?
I did not.
Say it again, Linda.
Our book says the third thing Jesus prayed was for those who would come to believe in him.
Yeah. In fact, he was praying for the church.
Yeah.
He's praying for the church.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, Jesus understood how easy it would be for the church to be characterized by divisiveness,
yeah,
and competition or exclusiveness. And he did not want these things to be the traits or the characteristics of his followers, of the church. And so, what specifically was he praying for? About the church?
They would be united.
They would be united.
Be one.
So the next question is, why was it critical that those following him be unified or united? Why is that such a big deal?
Mm-hmm.
He doesn't want, exactly, he doesn't want the world to see them as a divided people. Anything else?
That the world would believe that God sent him.
That the world would believe that God sent him?
Yeah. Well, I think we see it because he's stressed it before. A three-strand cord is not easily broken. There's strength when there's unity.
There's strength in unity?
And we even go back to the Tower of Babel.
Right.
God was amazed at what the people could accomplish.
Because they were united.
Because they were unified. And so it's a foundational principle that in unity, there's strength. And it is noticeable.
Okay, good. Pablo, were you in here? So, unity is important. He prays it. And this prayer is referred to in a lot of commentaries as Jesus' priestly prayer. You know, Jesus is the culmination of prophet, priest, and king. And here he's functioning in a priestly way as he's interceding. He's praying intercessory prayers over his followers. And so the unity of his followers is important to him. He emphasizes it, and he asks God the Father to let it be the case, let it be so, that they are unified. So, you know, we might be scratching our head a little bit when we read that, and we're tempted to think, well, apparently that prayer hasn't been answered yet because we're not so unified. I mean, we would be tempted to think that way when we look at the condition of the church. The church appears to be very splintered and all kinds of factions within the church. those who claim to be followers of Jesus Christ were like all over the board.
Uh-huh.
And we disagree on so many things with other people who call themselves Christians, and it makes us look bad.
But that's the scheme of the devil, right?
It is.
Because our unity is supposed to be part of Christ's character.
Right.
We're to display.
And our unity is a threat to him, to the devil.
Right. We're drawn to Christ, and we should be drawn to the church, to his church.
Right.
Because it is unified. In the world, you know, one minute you're heading this way, you think you need to buy a new truck, right? You know, you need a new house, you need all these new things. And that's not the purpose. You know, that's not the purpose. Like you said about Christ, we're supposed to be focused totally on him and his character. His purpose, his plan.
Well, I know we're just about out of time, but I want to just take a couple more minutes. We'll be okay, I think, to take a couple more minutes. You know, I remember we're now in 2021. It's hard for me to believe that it was 20 years ago. It'll be 20 years ago this coming September when 9/11 happened.
Wow.
We're coming up on 20 years. And I remember so well that day and how catastrophic it was. And I remember the response of our nation. And for a moment in our history there, and I don't know how many days it lasted or weeks, but we were drawn together in unity. And we kind of set aside all of our differences. And all the squabbling stopped momentarily, just for a moment.
Mm-hmm.
The squabbling stopped. It didn't matter what side of the aisle you were on. Mm-hmm. Everybody just kind of came together as a nation, and we were unified in our grief, in our response.
Mm-hmm.
And the church even rose for a moment and had a really great response to that. It didn't last very long. We went back to our normal craziness. But I will say this, because Jesus prayed that we would be brought to complete unity so that the world will know that the Father sent Jesus, I do believe Jesus' prayer will be answered. We will be brought, the people of God will be brought into complete unity, if for no other reason than Jesus prayed for it.
Mm-hmm.
Jesus prayed for it.
Right.
Causes us to adhere together, and so it's going to happen. It is happening. I'll say that it's happening. What's it going to take for us to really see it? I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm not being a prophet of doom, but I want to just say this. One thing that often draws the people of God together is persecution.
Mm-hmm.
Heaven forbid that it takes that.
I think the greatest example I know of with coming together was December 7th.
December 7th?
Which was even
Pearl Harbor?
Many times more than 9/11.
More than
9/11,
yeah, many of us were not alive then, so we don't remember that, but you're old enough to remember it, Mr. Cole. So adversity, persecution will cause people to put aside their differences and to come together.
Mm-hmm.
And so, yeah, I believe Jesus' prayer will be answered. And we've run out of time. We didn't even get to talk about God's glory, but maybe we can pick it up next week and just spend a couple minutes talking about seeing God's glory, because Jesus talks about that in his prayer. He prays for it. He wants the Father to glorify him so that the Father will in turn be glorified.
Mm-hmm.
And so that whole thing about God's glory, we'll talk about that a little bit more, but I guess we're out of time, so we'll stop. Let's pray. Lord, thank you so much for praying for us.
Mm-hmm.
Lord Jesus, we thank you that you prayed for us then and you continue to pray for us now.
Mm-hmm.
We thank you, Lord, that you are constantly mediating and interceding and intervening on our behalf. Thank you, Lord. We just ask you, Lord, to accomplish your perfect will in us and through us. Lord, conform us into your image with ever-increasing glory. And Lord, may you be glorified because of our lives and our witness. All the glory belongs to you, Lord.
Mm-hmm.
Let your glory cover the earth, even as the waters cover the seas. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord Jesus. In your name we pray. Amen. God bless you guys.